You know, I'm raw. I'm not quite sure why. You know, I do. I kind of know why. I mean, a couple things. You know, it's great actually to have Mark here, my husband. And I have so many people in this room actually that I so admire. I cannot begin to tell you. Kristen, Stacy, Karen, just so many people that I've gotten so much strength from over the years in some cases and in some cases recently. But Mark and I launched our daughter to college this fall. And I swear to God, I was like not going to be one of those parents that had empty nest. You know what I mean? I was just way too connected and like busy and had so many other things I love. And I do, and that's true. But I think that's created a certain kind of rawness for me this fall, without a doubt. And then this week, just yesterday, it's funny that I wanted to talk about engaged leadership because I really feel like in the last 5 or 10 years of my life and my work, you know, the thing I really focus on is love, love and connection. Because I really think that's where I find my passion, that's where I connect with other people's passion, that's where, you know, really great magical things happen, is really through love and connection. And yesterday at work, a guy that just was loved, I actually didn't know him well, I'd met him a number of times, but didn't know him well, died on his way to work. And you know, it is such a gift. Actually, it's such a gift because he and his wife both worked, and they both had eighth grade girls, twins in eighth grade. And he was just loved. And you know when somebody's so loved and you can just feel that from everybody else that knows that person. And, you know, I decided last night before I went home, I debated should I call Roseanne, that's his wife, you know, balancing my role, right, at the company of wanting to be caring and loving and show up, but wanting to also struggle a bit with privacy and wondering about. And I thought, well, when I went through my mom dying and my dad dying, and there actually wasn't a phone call I didn't appreciate, and if I didn't feel like picking up the phone, I'd let it go to my voicemail. So I thought I'll just call, and it'll probably go to her voicemail. And she answered the phone, and it was just such a moving 20 minutes. And it was a gift that, like, after I talked to her, I could just stand there at my desk at work. And it is a stand-up desk, so I literally was standing there, and just let myself actually feel those feelings and have other people around me, and then actually have a bunch of other conversations. So that's probably a big part of why I'm feeling raw. You know, I was thinking about what do you talk about when you stand up here, right? What do I get most when other people stand up? What do I get the most from, I should say, when other people stand up? And what I have found over the years is what really moves me is when I get a window into your authentic self. Like, that's what moves me. I wasn't the kind of kid that, in fact, I was an arts kid, so that's why I really should have been a musician if I could sing. I went to, it was all the arts. I went to a specialized school for performing arts. I studied that. My dad was in the arts. You know, I was the last person to guess that I would ever have the life that I have today. In fact, Adam said to me, when we were chatting once, he said, well, just tell people something they wouldn't know about you. And I was like, well, where could I possibly begin? You know, certainly I feel like I'm the last person to expect that I ever would have had the life that I've had or the journey that I've had. And so, you know, for me, a lot, you know, let me just tell you, so my real connection, how I really have grown, hopefully as a person, and how I hope I continue to grow as a person, is through getting a window into your authenticity and sharing a little bit of mine, you know, and really through, as I said, love and connection with people. And I think that that really, at the end of the day, it's, you know, might sound hokey, but that at the end of the day is a lot of what I see the work that I get to do on a regular basis is being about, you know. And when my early success, I will tell you, was really born out of fear, and I didn't know it. I didn't find out that I had a lot of fear until quite later in life. And part of it is I grew up in this artsy family that was a lot of fun, and I don't want to paint it as tragic, because it wasn't. It actually had a lot of really cool aspects to it, but it also had serious alcoholism, It also had serious challenges and things that happened, and I wasn't a kid that grew up with a lot of self-esteem, and I wasn't a kid that grew up with very high aspirations for what I would do in life. But at the same time, the funny thing that cracks me up when I think back is I was full, I think the way I manifested it, the way I dealt with it was I was full of this kind of overconfidence. You know, that was my way. I kind of learned to muscle my way through things. You know, and my early success in life professionally was really, and this is one of the things I love about stories, about people's stories, because when I really think about it, my success came out of my darkest weaknesses. It actually came out of my darkest weaknesses. Like, it came out of really low self-esteem. I mean, honestly, that was a lot. I worked my tail off. I knew I could never support myself in the arts. I fell into business, you know, and I just worked my tail off, mostly for a sense of recognition, a sense of belonging, you know, and I was actually known as being fearless. And that was, you know, the way I worked my way. And then I've spent most of the rest of my life trying to move away from that. You know, in fact, I was talking to Stacy and her daughter, and I was talking about this, and I said, he wants me to talk about something they wouldn't know, and her daughter, Katie, chimes up, tell them you moved to Vermont to be a waitress. That'll surprise them. And that's the truth. I did. We moved to Vermont to get away from it all, and really, I wanted to be a waitress because I was in college and I loved it. I really did. I did that, and then I kind of fell into business again, and then I leaned away from that, and then I would kind of, you know, I turned down, when I was offered an officer position at Green Mountain Power, I turned it down three times because I was so sure it wasn't the kind of work that I wanted to do. So through this process, I think the thing I really wanted to touch upon is, I still have weaknesses, obviously. I still have these parts of myself that I find great source of motivation from that probably aren't the best places to find them from, I guess. But what's happened and evolved over time is that through love and connection with people, through love and connection with the work that I've been able to be engaged in, you know, what has really happened is there's been, to use the Ignite word, there's been a passion that has been ignited in me. And you know, and some of it, so back to the good part. So I was talking about sort of some of the darknesses spurred a lot of my early success. I would say one of the positives that came out of growing up in this home that I grew up in is I was always the one that wanted to fix things. And there was a lot to fix. So I had a lot of material to work with. I was, and as my dad used to say, another one of his great one-liners was he said, Mary, you're the kind of kid, if we gave you a pile of shit for Christmas, you'd grab a shovel and be giggling and laughing and digging for the pony. Because you'd say, under all this, there must be a pony. So I was definitely the kid that was trying to figure out the better, you know, like how do we make this, we can get to this better place. And so that's a quality, that optimism, that getting to a better place. I mean, I think some of it came from I kind of wanted to fix the situation. And I worked really hard to try to fix that situation. But those same qualities I've learned are really fun and cool and wonderful qualities to have. And they've really opened up so many opportunities for me to work with amazing people and ignite my passion in a positive way. You know, and so I really feel like I'm the last one to ever expect that I would get to do the things I get to do. I have, back to fear, I have had the opportunity to get deeply in touch with my fear in my later years. You know, I love the line I was asked. I got the Courage Award a few years ago, and it was so comical because it was when, like, all the people were attacking us for the wind project, and it was, like, when the merger was going on, and there was this inaccurate and salacious campaign against us, and, you know, I wasn't feeling particularly courageous. But I remember, you know, the line that I really grabbed onto and I loved was, you know, true courage isn't the absence of fear. True courage is facing a wall of fear and making the decision to walk through it. So I'm really grateful because I was known as being kind of fearless and courageous when I was younger. And I can tell you, it was more the reckless, muscle your way through, I'll show you, you know. And the gift I've gotten in these last, I would say, 10 years in particular, is really to face the walls of fear and make a decision because of the passion I have about the other side, of why I want to get to the other side, to walk through it. And that is, and back to love and connection, right? Which is probably, you know, as I said, the most important thing to me. I actually think, it's actually my experience, that creating real love and connection with people, whether it's that moment on the street where you have a decision, you can make eye contact, you can smile, you can create happiness in the moment, or, because I can do this too, you think, I'm going to get to that door before you because I got to get my coffee ahead of you, you know. Whether it's those moments in life or whether it's moments in terms of the work that we do, the people that we work with, the people that we interact with, to me, showing up every day trying to do the work that I try to do or I want to do or the work that I aspire to do or the person I aspire to be, and to do that with love and connection and compassion actually entails walking through lots of walls of fear. Because I think at the end of the day, that is probably the biggest trait that separates us from each other. You know, small scale situations and large scale situations. So that's really what I have to share. You know, I feel really blessed to be able to have this opportunity. I unfortunately can't stay, so I won't. That's why I'm first. I'll stay a little bit, but I have to head out to another event. But I really want to tell you another part of one of the things I really appreciate about the gifts I've been given in life, for the work that I do, the opportunities that I get, is that I really do believe in making myself available to other people, because I would never have, you know, the story's long, obviously, it could take way more than 7 to 8 minutes. I would never have achieved anything that I've achieved, and I don't mean that by external success, I mean that by the things I've been able to achieve in my life in terms of connections to folks and having a really happy, deeply content life most of the time, if it weren't for so many other people sharing their authenticity with me and sharing their heart and their openness. So I extend that to you. So I won't be able to stay afterwards, but if there's anybody that feels like there's something I said that resonated with you and you'd like to talk about it a little bit more, understand a little bit more about where I'm coming from, I'm really easy to get a hold of. It's just my name at greenmountainpower.com. So thank you so much for the opportunity to be here.